Hi there.
Welcome to another Intel Technology Community Mailbag, also known as the Intel Tech AMA. I'm your host, Marcus Yam, Technology Evangelist at Intel. Today, we're answering questions on this, the Intel NUC 11 Extreme Kit, codenamed Beast Canyon. Back in August, we held a special Reddit AMA on NUC 11 Beast Canyon, and want to give a special thanks to the mods and Redditors who sent in questions and the experts at Intel who supplied the answers. Now first, a little background. NUC stands for Next Unit of Computing. It's all about innovation within smaller form factors, and Beast Canyon is just the latest example. NUCs have always been synonymous with small PCs, and while this NUC 11 may be bigger than all before it, it's still extremely compact for everything that it packs inside. Let's take a look, shall we? It's got a 65-watt Intel Core i9 or Core i7 processor that's part of the Tiger Lake family, PCIe 4.0, Wi-Fi 6E, and support for an even larger discrete graphics card than last year's gaming NUC, Ghost Canyon. In fact, the large size of today's GPUs is what dictated Beast Canyon's expanded footprint. At the heart of Beast Canyon is the latest Intel NUC compute element, which is a brilliant display of engineering that puts the CPU, memory, storage, I/O, practically the whole computer, in a single module that fits inside a single PCIe Express slot. The compute element first debuted in last year's smaller but mighty NUC, Ghost Canyon. And despite its 5-liter size and codename, its performance is the opposite of ghastly. In fact, this was my personal gaming PC over the last year, a year when I spent a lot of time inside at home, and it didn't leave me wanting for a bigger desktop, until now that Beast Canyon has dialed things up to 11. NUC 11. Now, let's get to the questions. All right, first up, we have a hot button topic, power and thermals. Accomplished Car 746 asks, how much of thermal headroom does the Intel NUC have, if any? Is there any ability to tweak power setting and undervolt like on Tiger Lake H? It's a great question. Thermal headroom is reliant on ambient temperature, so keep that in mind. As for modifying power settings, yes, you can go into BIOS to make changes, but for more flexibility and control, such as undervolting, you can do that using Intel's XTU tool. That's the Extreme Tuning Utility. We tuned NUC 11 to deliver great performance out of the box, but that doesn't mean you can't squeeze a bit more power out if you tinker with it. All right, one down. All right, what the? This is why this is so heavy? Okay. Luke Driftwood has this hard-hitting question. Why the minuscule cooling design for the 65-watt TDP desktop CPUs? Reviews all indicate it's inadequate and causes thermal throttling. Well, compared to the ambient coolers for desktops, the cooling design of the latest compute element may appear small. However, it is a very efficient vapor chamber design, optimized around the 65-watt TDP of the CPU. Remember, with the NUC, as much as Beast Canyon has grown, it's still about putting big capabilities inside small designs. And look at this thing. It's been engineered for airflow. And also, the BGA silicon used in the NUC 11 is very tolerant to long-term higher than normal temperatures when compared to true socketed desktop silicon. NUC design focuses on noise and thermal performance as a dual-prong approach. Our noise spec is much more restrictive than our thermal spec and has us targeting user experiences they're more likely to see, hear, and feel. And, if I might add, one of the early adopters of Beast Canyon has chimed in to say that it's working well thus far. Okay. All right, next we have a multi-part question from Allingby. First, for thermals, what informed going with the board designs, heatsink, and fan being up against the graphics card as opposed to a flipped sandwich style small form factor? Well, when approaching the first generation of NUC Element H product line, we were trying to focus on upgradability while following as much of the PCIe CEM spec as much as possible. And we followed this again for Beast Canyon. The second part of the question, on power, what informed going with SFX rather than Flex ATX when moving from Ghost to Beast? And the move from 10-pin back to 24-pin? Allingby was excited by the prospects of flat power supplies going mainstream. When comparing SFX versus Flex ATX, we should remember that Flex ATX means significantly longer power supplies with more noise because the space is restricted to a 40 by 40 millimeter fan. And the move from 10-pin to 24-pin allowed our baseboard to be more easily adapted into custom enclosures and off-the-shelf power supplies. And the final part of the question, will we continue to see pro options as with Ghost? 10 gigabit NUC Extreme is kind of a home lab dream. I hear you. Glad to see you're interested in the pro line of options. Now, Beast will not be offered in a pro version, but we're not done with that product line as a whole. All right, next up is a card. Well, happy Beast Day to you too. All right, so now that we've warmed up with all that thermal talk, let's get graphic. Graphics cards, that is. Particularly discrete graphics cards. Raytan 6 has three questions. First, which 3080, 3080 Ti, 3090 cards are compatible with Beast Canyon? There are so many designs out there, it's difficult to validate all of them with Beast Canyon. But overall, you'll want to look for dual slot 12-inch cards. For example, the EVGA XC3 lineup is compatible, including the 3080 that I have in here, and the 3090. Industry-wide supply shortages make it difficult to exhaustively test every card, but most dual slot cards will work inside Beast Canyon's 8-liter case. Second part of the question, is there an issue with FE cards since the fan blows onto the PSU? Assuming that you're asking about the Founders Edition cards, which are dual slot and do fit inside Beast Canyon, the FE cooler exhausts to the immediate wall and to the side of the power supply, but we didn't really see any stability issues. Third, and most final, is the M.2 slot on the bottom of the case PCIe4, and is it shared with the GPU? The M.2 slot on the bottom of the case is PCIe Gen 4 compliant, but it does bifurcate the X16 into an X8 when used. Oh, fancy. Next, we have a spooky question from Redditor Ghost Modley. Maybe after this you'll be Beast Modley? Okay, with so many DGPUs in recent years having 2.5 to 3 slot coolers, are there any reasons Intel decided not to make the NUC 11 Extreme a few inches wider to accommodate these? You know, we thought about it, and we had some discussions with the team. Now, while it may be something we consider in the future, for now we're trying to strike that balance between footprint and performance. And keep in mind, this is just the Intel NUC team's example of a design using the latest compute element. Other companies may offer different cases that can accommodate larger cards. All right, there's got to be a question about processors in here somewhere. Okay, here we go. Plenty Strategy 2 asks, are the processors being used for Beast Canyon fundamentally different from the laptop Tiger Lake H45, or are they just better binned and higher TDP? In a word, no. The Tiger Lake B series 11900KB and 11700B are fundamentally the same types of chips as the Tiger Lake H series 11980HK. They use the same type of support chips as well. Binned isn't really the right way to say it, but the message is basically the same. These chips are chosen to run at 65 watts PL1 and scale with a boost in power. You know what that sound means. It's time to talk overclocking. 1995 was a great year, and H1995 has a great question. Is memory overclocking supported in these KB-B CPUs? If yes, is it identical to Rocket Lake with gear mode stuff? Memory overclocking is supported in KB processors, and if you're thinking about pushing the memory, I would suggest using the XMP profiles with sticks that support them. The changing gear setting isn't available on these CPUs, as it is an option on the 11th gen Rocket Lake desktop processors. Now to round us out with the last couple of questions. Steak and Chicken Man wants to know, what is the biggest barrier you foresee in terms of cost scaling? And how much does a role of volume play for the Intel NUC Extreme series? Okay, probably the biggest barrier we have is the perception that small form factor can't deliver performance, which results in lower volume for gaming systems and thus becomes somewhat of a niche. We're hoping that innovations of the NUC gaming line, such as support for 12-inch graphics cards, changes the perceptions and leads to more demand, economies of scale, and more innovation. You also asked, as you continue to iterate on your roadmap, what areas are you focusing on improving most? The answer? Continue on pushing the performance for small form factor gaming rigs, including support for discrete graphics cards. And finally, Jay for Gem wanted to know that as NUC 11 Extreme is a descendant of the NUC 9 Extreme, the first product with the compute element, what are some of the aspects of NUC 11 Extreme that were most exciting to design? Well, to answer that question, we talked to Ray, one of our tech gurus in the NUC group, and here's what he had to say. There were so many fun elements to work on. 12-inch graphics cards were a top priority. The NUC 9 Extreme feedback definitely got the juices flowing. Also, End user requests for customization options resulted in a swappable in front panel RGB logo. In short, customer feedback drove the creativity. We also focused on a few key issues from a mechanical design target, focusing on making the element easier to open for component integration. In addition, we tried to combine headers into a more centralized position to clean up the shroud more. And by adding more M.2 capabilities, we have more M.2 options than most full-sized desktops. We're also excited to utilize vertical SODIMs that allowed for the extra M.2 slot. While it forced the fan into a new location, it allowed for the element to look and feel a lot more premium. And lastly, we were excited to make it a goal to keep as many screw captive as possible. At this point, I've been building PCs for decades, and captive screws have easily been one of the biggest improvements along the way. Thanks for that response, Ray. That's it for this edition of the Intel Technology Community Mailbag. We've got some very exciting news coming up, so make sure to subscribe and ask any questions you may have in the comments or at our Twitter handle at Intel Tech, and keep a lookout for the next AMA on the Intel subreddit. I'm Marcus Yam. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.
You're listening.
Oh, you know what that sound means. It's time to talk overclocking. Overclocking!